Hey everybody, welcome to the show. This is Dr. Levi with your show, The Dr. Levi Show. Today is March 1st, 2017. Absolutely beautiful day here in Los Angeles. It was chilly last night, but today is going to be spectacular. So I hope wherever you are today, you're making it a great day. You're talking about great shows. We have an amazing show for you today, talking about the Susan G. Komen Foundation, which is a foundation that's really at the precipice of pushing forth research and raising money for breast cancer awareness. So we're really happy to have a wonderful guest on today I'm going to introduce shortly. And I just want to remind everyone, please go to the website for Susan G. Komen and see what they're doing. They're doing amazing things internationally to really raise consciousness about breast cancer. You know, and I'll talk about breast cancer and some of the stats about it, but more importantly, I want you to educate yourself. I want you to go to the website. I want you to read about it. I want you to go to the CDC website, read about breast cancer, know about breast cancer, because unfortunately, cancer affects so many of us globally. Not simply breast cancer, but lung cancer, prostate cancer, colon cancer, melanoma, different forms of skin cancer. So I really want to let everyone know, hey, do what you can to be educated. Find out what you can do in your community to raise consciousness about this. But more importantly, educate yourself. You know, in October of this past year, I lost my really, really good friend, Rita Valente, who was an amazing person, great singer, great entertainer, and really one of my closest friends on the planet. And when she left us in October, it was really, really tough. Because it's always really hard when you lose people whom you love, but more importantly, when it seems like there's nothing you can do. And she went through multiple rounds of chemotherapy, and finally nothing seemed to work against the cancer, and finally she just made a beeline to heaven, you know, and she's truly, truly missed. And I know my story is one of millions of stories internationally of people who are touched by cancer. Cancer affects every life. I don't care who you are or where you are, you know somebody who has been touched by cancer. So this show is about raising awareness, raising money. I want to remind everyone that my team and I, on March 11th, will be doing a walk and a race here for the Susan G. Komen Foundation. Please go to the website and donate if you can. We really appreciate it. It can be $1 or 50 cents. Whatever you can donate would be great, because that change will make a difference to bring about a change. So there's no amount of money that you can give that's not going to be appreciated. And with our race, what I'm going to be doing is, right now we've raised, I believe, a little over $500. If we raise $1,000, I'm going to match that with $1,000. We raise $4,000, I'll match that with another $4,000. Whatever we raise, I will match that money. So I'm asking everyone in our studio audience to really do what you can to give and to donate, to be a part of this movement to really stop breast cancer, to stop cancer in general. I want to talk to you also about social media. I want to thank everybody for really subscribing, liking, and following us on all our social media platforms on Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, Twitter, as well as Twitch TV. You know, Twitch TV will be this Saturday, March 4th at 7 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. So thanks for joining us for that. It's just 1 hour broadcast, but it's really a lot of fun to interact with gamers from all over the world, from Australia, from New Zealand, from Ireland, from Canada, from the UK, from France, from Spain, from different parts of the continent of Africa. So I want to remind everyone to please join us, and we'll interact with you and answer your questions, of course. Now, let's talk about breast cancer. So breast cancer is the number one killer of Hispanic women who die from cancer in the United States. It's the number two cause of deaths from cancer for white women, African-American women. So if you think about that, that is a big swath of America. It's the number three killer of cancer in Native Americans, and I believe Pacific Islanders. So cancer, breast cancer specifically, is diagnosed in over 220,000 women per year, is diagnosed in over 400 men in the U.S. per year. And it kills like in 2013, the CDC stats, over 280,000 women died of breast cancer in 2013, and men, about 474 men died of breast cancer in 2013. Now, what is cancer? Well, let's talk about the generalities. Cancer is basically one cell that goes haywire, bananas, goes crazy, starts to multiply, multiply, multiply. And why this happens? Well, we don't know. We have some genetic markers like BRCA, BRCA1, and BRCA2. These are gene markers, and we know that that can be a part of the issue with someone who develops breast cancer, but not always. When it comes to breast cancer screening, you know, the current CDC practice is the following. If you're a woman 50 to 74 years of age, then every 2 years it's recommended that you have a mammogram. However, there's so much controversy about getting mammograms, of course. Now, there are some studies that have said that a woman 40 or older should get a mammogram every 2 years. And then there are some that say any woman that has symptoms of some form of breast idiosyncrasy, such as if she's having breast discharge that is maybe bloody or mucus-like, if she has a lump in her breast, if she has pain in her breast, increased tenderness, if she has pain in her breast that's really very severe, if she has dimpling of the skin in her breast, if she has a increased tenderness globally in her breast. There are so many different things that can be a part of this sequelae of breast cancer that can be the symptoms of someone having breast cancer. And sometimes I have to tell you, there can be no symptoms, nothing at all. Have no problem at all, but all of a sudden they'll go in, they'll get a mammogram, and then they may have stage 2, stage 3, or even stage 4 breast cancer. So the court, the medical court really, is really out on what is the best way to diagnose breast cancer. What are the best screening tools? And right now, the mammogram, as well as the other thing that's not talked about, of course, so often, is the self-breast exam. So not simply getting the mammogram, but also not being afraid to touch your own breast, to examine your breast. And I want to share something with you that a breast specialist shared with me many, many years ago. And that is, she said that it's so important that women examine their breasts standing up, but then they should also examine their breasts when they're laying down, because it changes the way the breast tissue will lay. Therefore, it may feel different in that plane versus standing up. So, and it's so easy, she said, to remind women to at least check their breasts when they're in the shower. You know, we shower every day, so why not do that then? So breast cancer is really a form of cancer that takes away too many people every year. And I think it's incumbent upon us to do what we can to raise awareness, to raise consciousness, and more importantly, let women know that if you feel something is off with your body, then you go to your doctor. And if he or she is not listening, guess what? You go to another doctor. You get a second or even a third opinion. But if someone says, oh, well, you're just hysterical about this, there's nothing wrong with you, oh, you're fine, oh, it's just your menstrual cycle, you're having breast tenderness, oh, you're on birth control pills, don't worry about it, you'll be fine. You know what? I don't want you to listen to them. I want you to take your health in your own hands. I want you to be your own advocate as well as your own healthcare provider. So if you feel that something is not correct with your breast, your body, then you go to someone else until someone listens. You know, and I bring that up because it's just like heart attacks. When a woman has a heart attack, a heart attack in a woman can present very differently from a heart attack in a man. Classically, a man who has a heart attack may have a feeling of heaviness on his chest, pain in his chin, a feeling of numbness and tingling down his arm, extreme fatigue. However, a woman who has a heart attack, she may have something very different. She may have a feeling of general malaise, that something doesn't feel right. She may have gastric pain. She may have esophageal pain. She may or may not have pain in her chest. She may or may not have chest pain. She may have back pain. She may have stomach ache. She may have some tenderness or pain in her shoulder or arm, but she may not. So there's so many studies now that show that when a woman goes to the ER with pain in her chest, or not pain in her chest, but with some some symptoms that are not the classic for a heart attack, she'll be sent home and said, oh, you just having indigestion. Are you okay? Go home and call us in the morning. Well, she may not be able to come back and call you in the morning. She may be dead by morning. So I want to remind everyone that women's health, men's health, they're very, very different because our bodies are very, very different. You know, the our bodies are tremendously different. And that must be recognized. That must be respected. And I really ask that the medical community now really goes full throttle now to respect women and to understand that when a woman presents with a problem, she should, number one, be respected, number two, be listened to, and number three, not be pushed to the side. All right. So those are my thoughts today. This is your Medical Minute, or maybe five or six, actually, about breast cancer and about breast cancer awareness and really about women's health and why women, I've always felt, should really be treated and respected as the goddesses and the muses that they are. They should not be pushed to the side. They should not be demoted. They should not be made to feel less than. It should be, of course, you know, equal pay for the equal job. It should be total equality. There really is no issue there for me. And I say that as a man, and I say it more importantly as a man who is a feminist. You know, I am for women's rights. I'm for equality of everybody's rights. And I think we have to talk about it because our country is so divided right now that if we don't have a conversation about it, then the misogyny, the idiocy, the stupidity, the division continues. We have to go through right now a state of healing. We have to go to a place now of listening to each other, respecting each other's rights as people. We have to respect someone who is a Muslim, someone who believes in Islam, someone who is a Christian, a Catholic, a Protestant, a Jew. It's all about respect. It's about respecting someone who is lesbian, gay, transgender, Q community. I mean, everyone should be respected. It's really not that difficult. And I say that today, again, in the face of so much hatred in our country right now. It has to be about stopping racism, stopping misogyny, stopping all these forms of divisiveness. It has to be about bringing ourselves together and recognizing that when we see another person, we're in effect looking in a mirror, we're looking at ourselves, be it man or woman. Everybody is a reflection of other people. And if you really think about how do we strengthen the fabric of humanity, we do that with respect, with love, with kindness, and with service and advocacy. You know, if you don't stand for something, you fall for anything. So we have to stand today. We have to stand for justice. We have to stand for equality. We have to stand for women's rights. We have to do that. And we have to stand for LGBTQ rights. We have to do what we can to make everything better. Speaking of better, I want to make one quick shout out to the Oscars. It was great to see that the Oscars went from Oscar so white last year to now Oscar very brown this year. Very interesting, I think. And I want to, you know, really congratulate all the winners who won, all the great actors, producers, sound effect people, special effect, the documentarists, everyone that won. And I also want to also congratulate everyone that was nominated, because you should also be respected. So I want to thank everyone for their contributions. And the Oscars here in Hollywood is a big deal, and it's a big deal internationally. So to all the winners, congratulations. One last thing, the president gave his, you know, you would say it's not a State of the Union address, but because he did address Congress last night, you could really say it was almost a State of the Union type address. So let's just hope that our country will become a country of greater tolerance, of peace, of more compassion, of more acceptance, of less divisiveness. Let's hope that his speech last night, which was filled with generalities, will really produce specifics about change. And let's hope that Obamacare, which has given so many people health care coverage, will continue or be made better. But I want to say this, Obamacare can't simply go away. Too many people will lose out. Too many people will actually die if they don't have coverage. So with that said, when it comes to life and death situations, let's get back to our topic of the day, which is breast cancer. So as I said earlier, so many people are touched with different forms of cancer in their lives. But I want to say thanks to the Susan G. Komen Foundation, they're making a difference. They're making crossroads with respect to raising money, greater awareness and greater consciousness about what can be done to continue this battle to stop cancer and specifically to stop breast cancer. So I want to welcome our guest today. I want to welcome Marvina, who's here today representing the Susan G. Komen Foundation. I want to thank you, Marvina, for being here. It's really wonderful to have you.
Thank you, Dr. Levi. I appreciate that.
Absolutely. Let's talk about your involvement with Susan G. Komen. What was your push to be a part of this organization, which does so much really fantastic work?
That's a long story.
I want to hear it. We got a lot of time. We got 50 minutes.
I was inquisitive.
Yes.
I was inquisitive. My story is breast cancer does not run in my family.
Yes, but I will say this. It doesn't run in your family. It doesn't discriminate either.
That's exactly right. That's the truth. Yeah. And about maybe 5 years ago,
yes,
my cousin, who we were raised as sisters.
Yes.
She lost her mother at an early age, and my parents legally adopted her, and we were raised in the same household.
Yes.
So I consider her my younger sister.
Yes.
Was diagnosed with breast cancer. Now, she was 25 when she first felt lumps in her breast.
This is your cousin, Arlise Marshall.
Yes.
Yes.
Arlise.
Yes.
And she is still with us. She's a survivor. And she was 25 when she first felt lumps. And like you mentioned earlier, she told her doctor, hey, this doesn't feel right.
Yes.
Something's going on. And her doctor says, oh, it's your administration.
Uh-huh.
Your
menstrual cycle.
Menstrual
don't
cycle.
Worry about it. It'll
don't
go away.
Worry about it. It'll go away. Mm-hmm. It never went away.
Right.
A year later, same doctor, she sought advice from and thought, you know, something is really going on.
Right.
At this point, she was now pregnant.
Mm.
So the doctor's like, well, your hormones are off. You're pregnant. Let's see how it goes after the pregnancy. Your hormones are off. Again, she still ignored it. Taken or seeking the advice of this same doctor.
Right. So nothing was done nearly now for
2 years.
Two
full years.
Wow. So she had the baby also.
She had the baby.
Thank goodness for that.
And very healthy, nursing.
Right.
It wasn't until when she started nursing and the milk was discolored.
Mm.
And, you know, I don't want to get too graphic, but...
Yeah, often we talk about if there's bloody nipple discharge.
She had bloody nipple discharge.
Is very, very common, symptomatic for some form of badness going on.
That's exactly what happened.
Yes.
Well, and so finally, the doctor, this is the 3 years into her speaking to 3 years later to this physician. And finally, he listened, he or she listened,
right,
and immediately got her a biopsy, which she was at stage 3 at that point.
Unbelievable.
And I was inquisitive. I didn't know anything about breast cancer.
Right.
I didn't know. What I knew is what I was learned at a very early age.
Right.
You don't have to get mammograms until you're over the age of 50.
Mm.
If you're under 50, you can't get breast cancer because that's the stories
many
that
people,
was told.
Yeah, they think those fallacies are real, but they're not.
Right.
Right.
And so my inquisitive behavior and asking a lot of questions,
yes,
asking questions to the right people, trying to seek advice for my cousin, baby sister,
right,
really is what led me to Susan G. Komen. And from there, I got a board position, which I did graciously accept. And again, just asking a lot of questions, meeting with various doctors, bringing other people on our board.
Yes.
Did I now become the president of Susan G. Komen LA County, which was not in my path at all.
Right.
I was just inquisitive and needed,
right,
to learn more. I'm a student of life by nature.
Absolutely.
And I just needed to know what this disease was and,
right,
and how did this happen?
Exactly.
She's only 28 at this point.
Unbelievable.
So that's my story, and that's how I got so actively involved.
Right. Now, what about your sister now? Where is she in her healing? And also, where is she emotionally about what she went through? Because this is all devastating news to go 3 years undiagnosed.
It
and
is.
Then when you are finally diagnosed, well, not just diagnosed, let me say this, but finally listened to, then you're at stage 3. That is really reprehensible.
It was torture.
It had to be.
She, like I said, thank God she is a survivor. She's one of the lucky ones.
Yes. Yes.
Her child is 100% healthy.
Thank goodness for that.
Emotionally, she struggles. I mean, who wouldn't?
Right.
The support group, it's hard to find support groups as well.
Right.
So that was another trying to seek out, like, there has to be plenty of women that's gone through this.
Of course, she's not the only
experience.
One. Right.
Where can we find support groups in LA?
Right.
Who, you know, who do you reach out to? And these questions are not really easy to find.
No, not at all.
Although they are there.
Yes.
You know, we have support groups.
Right.
There, and we are trying through Susan G. Komen, we are making, especially since now that I've been in president, right, a visual community standpoint. Like, we are really visually out there in your face.
Yes.
Specifically in low-income families,
right,
areas,
right,
low to mid-income areas,
right,
specifically, because those are the areas and the communities that have the least amount of resources.
Absolutely.
And the least amount of information where to find those,
right,
resources.
Right. Right.
And so we really, we have a mammogram truck,
right,
that we drive around.
Which is fantastic.
Free mammograms.
Which is fantastic.
We
which
do.
Is fantastic.
We have a location on our website,
right,
where you can go and get your free mammograms.
Right.
We really, really push for that,
right,
in African American and Hispanic communities.
Absolutely. You know, and I want to say too to everyone, there's I'll have it by the end of the show. There's a 1-800 number by the CDC where they also offer, mm-hmm, free mammograms for low income individuals. So I want to let everyone know, and our listening, viewing audience, that you are not alone, number one. Number two, there are resource sources that are available for you. Number three, if you need help, as Marvina said, Marvina Peters, she's available, you know, to give talks, to speak about this. She's available to give you information. Susan G. Komen Foundation is available to give you information. It's a phenomenal, phenomenal foundation. And I want to say to you today, if you need my help to, mm-hmm, volunteer, to be a part of it, to do anything on the board, I would do that.
Awesome.
I mean this with the most profound authenticity I can extend to you. I'm available. I will do what I can to help.
And let me tell you, Dr. Levi, I keep men to their words.
Well, so trust me. I'm a man of my word.
I believe you.
Not a problem. I live by it.
Thank you so much because we need that.
Yes, you do. And you need physicians, I believe. You need general lay people, of course. But you also need people in the medical community to,
absolutely,
step up and say, hey, what can I do to make a difference? And not just have their hand out saying, I'll do it if you pay me.
Right.
You know, we have to have physicians who will step out and say, I will volunteer my time. Because in medicine, I have to say, we're so blessed. And I still live by the moniker that to whom much is given, much is required. So I think you only give what you're willing to give away. So why not give of our time, our talent, and our treasure? Because we have so much.
Mm-hmm.
In medicine, we're given so much. So why not give to help other people? We really have to do that.
That's sincere. I really appreciate that because we do need that.
Oh, I really mean it. And I want to remind everyone that our team, you know, Dr. Levi team, we're raising money. We're going to participate on March 11th. We're going to be walking and running. Right now, we've raised over 500. Our goal is 1,000 plus. And whatever we raise, I'm going to double that and match that. So I'm hoping we'll raise like 4,000 so I can give 4,000 more.
That's incredible.
The goal here is really to raise money for research, but also to let people know about Susan G. Komen Foundation. It's been around for a while.
Oh, wow. You know, and let me just, real quick.
Yes, ma'am.
You just brought up something that is really important, and we really thrive on this. I am very honored to say that 75% of our net proceeds that we raise in the communities go right back into those communities to which we raise them.
Which is fantastic.
And I'm very, very proud of that. 25% goes to research, goes,
right,
back to National for Research. But it really makes me feel good to know that I'm part of an organization that I'm raising money in this community for this community.
Absolutely. The money stays there.
That's exactly right.
It's not
right.
Like you're raising money here and then it's going
and it's sending
anywhere
it, exactly,
else.
Exactly. No. And so that's really important to me.
It's very important.
And which makes donating and
yes, critical.
Exactly.
Critical. Yeah, you know, we want people to know about you. We also want people to open their wallets, their pocketbooks, their suitcases of money. We want them to send it in. We want that. We want that. You know, when you're a part of an organization like this, what does it do for you every day when you wake up knowing that you're truly making a difference? What does that feel like for you?
It makes my heart smile. I know it's, I feel, you know, it's a small piece in this huge world. Right. The moment that I found out that 70% of the mortality rate in African American communities is 70% higher than there are in Asian and white community due to breast cancer, I was blown away.
Right.
Why is the mortality? This is the same disease, well, whether
same
it's
disease.
In a black woman or a white woman or an Asian woman. This is the same disease.
Yes.
How is it the mortality rate in LA County
is so
70% higher?
Right.
And we came to the conclusion that it's lack of resources,
lack of education, misinformation, and fear.
Yes. And fear of actually getting that mammogram and walking into and getting
Absolutely.
That mammogram done. Yes.
Let me tell you, I just had maybe a month, almost 2 months ago, had a conversation with one of my patients. So we were talking, and she's like 59. And so I was asking, I said, well, you know, we were talking about her general health, and we talked about her carpal tunnel issues and how she was recovering from surgery. And then I said, you know, I said, we never talked about your general health issues. When was your last mammogram and your pap smear and all of that? She says, oh, I stopped getting those 20 years ago.
Oh.
20 years ago. I said, you know what? That's going to stop this week. I said, this week, you're going to go and get all those things done. She said, who's going to make me? I said, the guy you're looking at right now.
I heard that.
You know? And she started laughing. She said, well, my husband can't make me go. I said, I'm not your husband, though. I'm your doctor.
Yeah.
I said, I'm the guy that wants to see you live a long, happy, prosperous life
in
good health. I said, so you have to do it this week. And so she went. Everything was clear. But it's good to know that everything is clear
versus
to say, well, I'm just not going. I don't want to do that. We have to remind people that taking care of your health is non-negotiable. It's not a choice. You have to do it. It's like breathing, going to the bathroom, eating. Right. Well, you got to go get your health care looked at. And some people won't do it. Another guy I can share with you. This was just last week. You know, he and I were talking. He's 63, 64. And he was telling me he was trouble urinating quite a bit.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, well, you know, your carpal tunnel didn't cause that. And so we kind of laughed about it. And he said, well, what do you think I should do? I said, you have to go get checked. I said, you got to get your prostate checked. You have to go see a urologist. He said, oh, no, I don't want to have anyone check putting their finger in my rectum, checking my prostate. I said, well, let's see. Checking a finger in your rectum, checking your prostate versus death, which do you want? He said, well, I never thought about it that way. I said, well, you have to think about it that way. I said, it's a quick 30-second exam, if that. I said, you have to have these things checked. So I think so often in many communities, especially communities of color, I see this real lack of knowledge about what needs to be done to be healthy and to live a long, sustainable life. You have to get yourself checked.
And then not putting yourself first. Why aren't you a priority to your own life?
And I say that especially to women. I think women in general will prioritize everyone else in their families except themselves. If they're a mother or not a mother, women in general will make sure everyone else in the household is well taken care of, that they've gone to the dentist, their teeth are great, that their health is great, but they will put themselves last. And I want mothers who are listening, I want you to know four things. Number one, you are worthy. Number two, take care of yourself first. Number three, if you're not healthy, no one in the house is going to be healthy. And number four, remember this. Your health and what you buy for your family, the food, will dictate everything everyone eats. If you don't buy it, they won't eat it. You know?
Thank you for adding that.
It's the truth.
Oh, my gosh. That's one thing mothers, we're nurturing.
Absolutely.
And so, yes, we'd make those doctor's appointments for our kids, our husbands, the dentist appointment.
Yes.
And you're right. We leave ourselves out. But one thing that we don't consider is the food that we bring into the household.
Oh, absolutely.
Or the last thing we would consider.
Absolutely.
Is the type of, so this is cheaper, so I'm going to buy that. But that's not necessarily what's best for your family.
That's correct.
So thank you so much for adding that because that's very important, a part of this equation in staying healthy as well.
It really is because, you know, in medicine in general, we often say that food is 85% and diet and exercise, excuse me, exercise is the other 15%. But what you eat is critical because you are what you eat, drink, and smoke. So if you do those things that are not good for your health, your body's going to reflect that. Mm-hmm. A body that exercises looks like it exercises. A body that doesn't exercise looks like it doesn't exercise. Right. And I say that not for anyone to feel bad about themselves, but I say it as a wake-up call for all of us to do what we can to be fit, to do what we can to be healthy, to do what we can to make healthier choices about what we eat, because fitness is a lifestyle. Being healthy is a lifestyle. And I challenge everyone to make the right choice, to put away the trash food, the food that is filled with dyes and sugar and soy and salt and all those things that you can't pronounce. If you can't pronounce it, most likely it's not good for you. If it's full of dye, most likely it's not the best thing for you. If it has so much sugar in it and very little protein and a lot of fat, possibly it's not good for you. And why do we buy things that have fat and sugar? Well, it tastes good. I mean, the FDA, they know that now. People in the food industry know that. If you want someone to buy something, let it be salty, let it be sugary, let it be tasty, let it be filled with fat. You got people who are going to be repeat offenders. They're going to keep coming back. So I really think that food has to be a part of the equation.
Well, you're right. There's no shadow of a doubt. We talk about breast cancer, but realistically, the whole person, health as the whole person,
is where
the healthiness lies.
I totally agree with you. No, Susan G. Komen, what do they do in a community with respect to an awareness of bringing people together who have been survivors to talk about it? Are there those support groups that are in what I call areas whereby education is just not there, or they don't have the support, they don't have the money? Do they go into low-income areas to provide education and healing?
Yes, we do. We have volunteers that volunteer their home.
You got me now.
Yes, thank you so much. We have volunteers all over LA County. Inglewood, Compton, Long Beach, just to name a few off the top of my head. Right. East LA, that volunteer their homes where there are support groups that come in. It's very organized, very structured, and you can just pop in. There's no level of expectation. Either you could show up or not show up, or you will show up this week and not show up the next. There's no completely stress-free, and you could just drop in, get as much information as you like. We have a field team, if you will, that are out educating the community and really bringing knowledge really through all the communities, through our mobile van, our mobile mammogram van, setting up free mammograms, as I mentioned earlier. But at those mammograms, there's a wealth of information, outreach groups that are in that local community. Depending on where the van is, we have all that information out on the table where people can
have access to.
And this also is on our website as well.
It's fantastic. The other thing I've been curious about, too, what about having things in bilingual, you know, or do you have
stuff
in different languages?
Yes, we do.
Fantastic.
Absolutely.
You know, because I would think that if you, a community in East LA may be very different from a community in Long Beach.
That's exactly correct.
Or in Studio City or in the Valley.
Absolutely. You know? Very, very correct. We also have small businesses that help us spread the words as well.
Fantastic.
So we will go into a local hair salon or barbershop.
That's the way to do it.
Yes. So we really are trying to come up with creative ways to keep various community, low-income communities specifically, educated, but at the same time, pushing for those mammograms, trying to deflect that fear that are in people, and really trying to figure out a way, okay, well, it's free. Right. Why aren't you showing up to get a mammogram? And getting some feedback.
Right.
And a lot of times it's because of fear.
Or, that's true.
You know, we'll hear excuses like, I don't have a babysitter.
Right.
Well, that's okay.
Bring them.
I'll watch
you. Exactly. I'll watch you, baby. Bring them on.
Really? That's what we say.
I love that. You know,
bring the kids.
One thing I really love about what your organization is doing is bringing knowledge and information as well as the mammogram van to areas of low income. Because I've often thought that some of the most disenfranchised communities are the ones that are always deprioritized. They're the ones that are thought of as being less than, that they don't matter. Mm-hmm. I remember as a kid, you know, not having insurance and being with my mom as a single parent and always knowing that she would prioritize the health care for me and my sisters and her own health, not so much. So I think it's so important now that we let people know that there are organizations like Susan G. Komen that will help you. Mm-hmm. It doesn't matter your socioeconomic level, because cancer does not discriminate. Anyone can be a victim of it. Mm-hmm. Anybody. So if you have knowledge and get the test, hopefully we can do what we can to help you.
Right. I also like to say that as mothers, when we are nurturing,
yes,
what's going to happen when you're no longer here?
Speak it.
And
that's the
your
truth.
Child or your husband
or your children,
yes, are now living without a mother.
Exactly.
Because you were selfish and right. didn't get yourself checked
exactly.
out. That's really how I like to right. phrase it. And
that's
really
a very powerful statement. That's a very beautiful way you said that.
Yeah.
Very I mean, beautiful. I love what Ms. Marvina Peters said. That statement is, women should really be selfish about their health in order to be a provider of the family, to be around. That's very powerful.
Oh, yeah. Because that's what it boils down to.
It really does. Wow, selfish. I want to say it again. It's so that resonates. That women should be selfish about their health care to be here for their families.
Mm-hmm.
Wow, very, very bold statement. You know, often people think selfish is a bad thing.
Right.
In this case, not at all.
Mm-hmm.
It really, really isn't. You know, what is your vision for yourself as being a part of Susan G. Komen? Where do you see yourself, say, 2 to 5 years from now as a part of this organization?
Wow. My goal right now, that's a beautiful question, and thank you. My goal really is to educate as many low-income families as I possibly can.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
We want to double the amount of mammograms that we received last year. So it's so hard. I can't express how difficult it is to get women to be selfish for their help and get
right.
women to get a breast examination
right.
and to get women to come out for mammograms. So like 2 years from now, I'd love to see, we're at about 5,000 mammograms in a 2-year time frame. I'd love to see that double, triple.
Wow. Wow. I'd love to see that happen too.
You know, I'd love to see our vans out more than once a month.
Right.
Because right now, with the volunteer staff that we have, we can only have that truck out once a month in different areas.
Hmm.
So I'd love to see that truck out, you know.
Every day.
Yeah. You know,
every day.
A lot more often
yeah.
than just once a month.
Let me tell you, I intend to be there with you. I intend to do what I can to make a difference. That's for sure. I intend
mm-hmm.
to be there. I think what you're doing has such resonance in a community, because, and when I say community, I mean the human community.
Yes.
Because what you're doing, it will help people be alive.
Right. It's educating.
Right.
You know, and that's where, when I realized, that's where I lacked in helping my sister when she went through this.
Exactly.
I wasn't educated, and
right.
so I didn't like that feeling.
Exactly.
And
you want to know.
Yes.
And thank God Arlise Marshall is still here with us.
Thank God
that she was finally diagnosed properly, treated properly, and that she's still here.
Right.
You know. Now, we're going to take a quick break here. We have a call. Hi, this is Dr. Levi.
Hi, this is Dr. Levi. This is Daniel Campos Canton. How are you?
Oh, hey, Daniel. How you doing? How's Jorge Nuno doing?
He's doing excellent. We actually, he's a little tied up right now with an endorsement
nope.
in the health industry. We're trying to get him endorsed, and so we're doing very well.
Well, you know, you got my endorsement. You got my endorsement, and here at the Dr. Levi Show, and I believe even at UBN Radio, I mean, we're making a push for you. You know, we hope that next Tuesday will be extraordinarily successful. And I just want to thank you and Jorge for doing what you can to make the community better.
Well, yeah, thank you very much. We appreciate your endorsement more than anything. Believe me, it really meant a lot when you put Jorge's story out there. Like I said before to you in person, it's like you were the first one who were able to pull out that real story from Jorge, you know, and have a lot of humor in the story. And it was amazing because it really talks about real candidates talking about their personal life, which you normally don't get that from
Absolutely.
Any candidate. They have an agenda. They come in. They give you questions that they want you to ask.
Yes.
And this was very natural and organic. And we appreciate that because it shows the quality of person that Jorge is, and also how he is for the community.
Well, we want to thank you again, Daniel, for calling in. And we want to say to Jorge Nuno, we wish him the best next week, and we thank him for being a vital part of the community. He's someone who's about making a change in a community that's really been dispossessed by many people and thought of being less than and really disenfranchised. So our goal with this show, the Dr. Levi's show, is letting the world know that, number one, everybody matters, and that Jorge Nuno is doing a great job of stepping forward to being a part of the community that he represents. He lives in the community that he represents. So I want to thank you for calling in, Daniel. And Jorge Nuno, I want to be there when he celebrates on the day that he wins. And I just know that everything will work out for the best. And again, you have my support here at the Dr. Levi Show. Let me know how you need me to volunteer, and I will be there.
Yes, you know, thank you very much. Right before we leave, I just want to thank you, Janet, of course, for all the support. Thank you. We're going to have a celebration, not in a fancy hall, none of those things. We're actually going to go into Hood, which is central, and Florence. There's a restaurant called Milindo Nayarit, right in the middle of the Hood, where everybody gets together. All kinds of community members get together to this place. It's very famous. Shout out to the family there, Herrera, who's the one allowing us to have the party there. But most important, March 7th, from 8 a.m. to 8 p.m., everybody gets to go to vote. This is an important and historical election. Jorge has been endorsed by the L.A. Times, which is the only candidate endorsed outside of, you know, of in this particular district.
Yes.
You know, and they said he's the only grassroots guy, you know, because they understand the work he's been doing. And on top of that, we are ahead in the polls. As a matter of fact, our opponent is extremely nervous. They're expending thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars just to defeat us. And the latest news that we have to put out there, the tobacco company has put right now $100,000 just to help our opponent to get elected. So that tells you what the interest in he's representing.
Yes.
And it's important for people to know this, because we need to vote for the best interest of the community, and
Absolutely.
That is Jorge Nuno.
Absolutely. Jorge Nuno is the guy. And I want to say, too, even if he gave them money, you know, all money's not good money, and people forget that. So I think no matter what, Jorge is the guy. He is the grassroots campaign guy. He is the guy that will make a difference. He is someone who stands and lives in that community, and he is someone who is the voice of that community, has been the voice of that community for many, many years, from having the big house there to all the great things that the big house has done in that community. He stands alone as the number one candidate for that job. So I stand by that, and I believe that everything will be fine for him. So I want to thank you again, Daniel, and let Jorge know we wish him the best. And again, Jorge Nuno has my vote, and he has my vote here at the Dr. Levi Show. Thanks, Daniel.
Thank you very much, Dr.
All right. Take
hello
care.
To everyone. Hello.
Absolutely,
to
man. Bye-bye. You know, that was one of the candidates calling in, Jorge Nuno. Mm-hmm. He's running this coming Tuesday, and he's representing an area of Los Angeles that's really been quite dispossessed. So it's great to have him call in, his representative call in.
Nice.
I want to say, you know, I'm just so grateful that you took time to come to the show today to talk about how breast cancer has impacted your family, to talk about the great success of Arlise Marshall, that after finally pushing through after 3 years, she's finally properly diagnosed. And then I want to really thank you for your commitment to the communities to really make a difference. You know, it takes strong, phenomenal, as Maya Angelou would say, you really are one of those phenomenal women, to really go forward and make a difference, to say that you won't stand by and see things happen without being an advocate, and more importantly, about bringing forth change with your actions.
Thank you, Dr. Levi. Yeah. You're thanking me, but really, I need to be thanking you for spreading the word and offering this show and welcoming me to the show.
Absolutely.
So I can assist and spread my vision.
Oh,
I really appreciate it.
You know, we really appreciate you. When Janet and I talked about having you on the show, it was like a no-brainer. It was like. Why didn't we do this even earlier? This is like fantastic. And having our fundraiser with my team is like, it's the perfect time by the grace of God.
And that's right. March 11th
yes.
marks our 20th
that's
Race
great.
For the Cure
yes.
anniversary. So we're really excited about that.
I'm excited.
And thank you so much for putting a team together.
Of course.
And I have a team myself. It's such a fun day.
It really is.
There's going to be a live band. Yeah. We're going to have the Rams cheerleaders. Right. It's a really fun day. It's a family fun day.
Exactly.
So bring the kids out. Right. There's going to be a kid tent where face painting and.
That'll be me. Trust me, I'm just a big kid.
It's a really fun morning.
I can't wait. My whole team, we're all excited about it. My office is going to be it's going to be fantastic, you know. And more importantly, it's about raising money and really making a difference.
Yes.
And it's one thing to talk about it, but it's not, as you know, we live in a city where people do a lot of talking. It's not about the talk. Mm-hmm. It's about your actions.
Yes.
Do you do what you say?
That's exactly right. And can I depend on you?
Can I depend on you?
Can I count on you?
Right.
When I need
you. Right. Are you going to show up?
Yes.
You know, it's like my grandmother said, you always know your friends when you're moving because they will show up. You know, other people say, I'm going to try to get there. What time you need me? Mm-hmm. How many boxes you going to have? But your friends won't ask that. They will just simply show up.
Right.
You know, my mother has a statement that friends do one thing, and that is they show up. They show up financially when they can and if they can. They show up physically to help you when they can. They show up emotionally to help you get through things. Mm-hmm. They show up spiritually to pray with you when they need to. And I've always loved the wisdom of my mother saying that because I think it's true.
I believe that. I believe your friends are the family you choose.
Absolutely.
I value them.
Oh, very much so. Because we choose our friends.
That's right.
Right. Family, kind of stuck.
That's right.
You know, and sometimes that's a good thing, and sometimes that's a challenge.
It's the truth.
Right. It's the truth. Yes, it is. It's the truth.
It's
Now, let's talk about what do you do when you're not involved with Susan G. Komen? What are the other outside pursuits that you have?
I celebrate with my friends.
Fantastic.
My friends are truly my family that I choose.
Yes.
We support each other. I own a real estate and property management firm.
What's the name of that firm?
Teresa Peters Executive Realtors.
How can people reach you on that?
Oh, TeresaPetersOffice.com. We're based in Inglewood, and our market is the South Bay Market.
You got to get Teresa Peters. You got to get to that website, TeresaPeters.com?
TeresaPetersOffice.com.
Office.com. Mm-hmm. TeresaPetersOffice.com. They have my vote. Fantastic.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
Thank you. And my my give back is I house victims of domestic violence.
Ooh, so very powerful.
I purchase distressed properties as an investor or rehab them and house victims of domestic violence.
That's a real, I tell you, you're just a mega woman, a real modern day Wonder Woman.
No. Yeah,
you are, you know, you're humble about it. But, you know, in my practice, at least once every 2 to 3 months, I am taking care of a person of spousal abuse.
Okay.
And sometimes women, sometimes men, actually. And it's so important that people know they have a way out, that they're not stuck. You
right.
know, I remember my mom, you know, like my dad, you know, we always talk about the types of a drunk. There's the happy drunk, the crying drunk, the sleepy drunk, and the violent drunk. My dad was the violent drunk. And I can remember him beating the hell out of my mom so often. And then we go to Sunday church like everything was okay. You know, she'd wear black glasses, mm-hmm. black eye, but everything mm-hmm. would be okay. So I think domestic violence is something that we do have to talk about. And I think it's great that you're involved with making a difference in that community because they really need you also.
It's not a pretty topic.
No, it's not.
At all.
But it's a real topic.
It's real.
Right.
And it's still very much embarrassing to many people.
Right.
But
and shameful. Well, a lot of people have shame about it.
And they're victims.
They're the victim.
Yeah.
Right. Why should you feel bad about the one who's hitting you?
Right.
He's the bad one, not you.
Right.
You know,
we could talk about this
all
day.
We really could. We're going to have you back on to talk about that. Because that's very important. You know, we've talked about domestic violence before, but we'll definitely have you back on to talk about that. How that reversal, that paradigmatic shift, where the victim feels like they're the bad one.
Right.
It's like the rape victim feels like she brought it on because her skirt was too this or her dress. She didn't bring that on. It was the person that did it to her, the power trip, the evil person. It's not that's the bad person, not her.
And then think about the kids
exactly.
in that household.
Yes.
And then what they're going to grow up,
thinking
what they
see. Right.
So it's
a big deal. No, we're gonna have you back on to talk about that. I wanna go back on top and just remind everyone. March 11th, Susan G. Komen, Walk, Race for the Cure.
Please. You could register at LA, KomenLA.com. Excuse me, KomenLA County Fantastic. We have several affiliates. We want to do ComanLACounty.org to register for the race. March 11th, we're starting at about 7:30 a.m. The race starts at 8, but we want to get you there early, 6:37, to get you registered, get you t-shirts,
parking and all that stuff.
And it's really a fun day. You could walk it, you could run it, you could stroll your baby, you could walk your dog.
Don't forget about the face paint.
Yeah. It's a really fun day.
It's going to be fantastic. I want to thank Marvina Peters for being here. She's a really dynamic Wonder Woman. And I want to thank everyone for joining us on Facebook, subscribing and following us on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, YouTube. Really grateful to be of service. Grateful for our new video that we just released several days ago. It has like over 30,000 views in 2.5 days, I think, now, which is really fantastic. I remind everyone to join us on Twitch TV this Saturday, March 4th at 7 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. I want to remind everyone that the Susan G. Komen Foundation is phenomenal. So give of your time and your treasure and your talent. They're available. And as I told Ms. Peters, I'm ready to be a part of their board to do what I can to help. And I want to remind everyone, be kind to other individuals. And number one, you matter. Be selfish about your health. This is Dr. Levi. I'll see you next week. Susan G. Komen, March 11th. Bye.